Good evening. Welcome to, I guess it's actually our second event. We had Congressman Paul Ryan here last week during orientation week. But this is our first event of the regular season, and one that's, I think, very apt, and it will help frame some of the other discussions we have this year. And I really wanted to have this discussion because I think that the status of the middle class in this country, the status of what we used to call the American dream, is something that's coursed through our politics for several decades, and it's created a permanent sense of disquiet that has a lot to do with the volatility in our politics. I have three slides here that kind of tell the whole story and hopefully will frame the discussion that we're about to have. This one traces the growth of GDP and real median family income from about 1960. And you see about in the mid-70s, those two lines diverge and the economy continued to grow, but family income did not. And if you took that line back to the end of World War II, it would continue to be, it would be a straight line up until that point. So for about 20 years after the war, let's take a look at the next slide. This one runs from 92 forward. The blue line is productivity, and you can see how much productivity has grown. Obviously, technology has a lot to do with that. The GDP also has grown, but household incomes have flattened, and obviously the recession did real damage to it. And then the final slide is one that measures economic mobility across developed countries, and there you see the U.S. is down at the bottom, which is a kind of a shocking thing when you consider what we consider to be our heritage as a country, and the ability, the notion that if you work hard in America, you can get ahead, and everybody can get a fair shot. I think taken together, these slides say a lot about what is driving our politics today. And so it's perfectly fitting that the first discussion we have at the Institute of Politics is about this subject. And we have a tremendous panel and great guests today to lead that discussion. And to introduce them, let me, Will Fernandez, who is the president of our student executive board. Will.
Thank you, David, and good evening and welcome to all of you. My name is Will Fernandez. I'm the senior chair of the Student Executive Board here at the Institute of Politics. It can't be a really more fitting opportunity tonight to be talking about issues that are uniquely important to each and every one of us in a unique and important way. As a college student in an era of historically high rate of student debt and a recalling workforce that leaves 16.8% of college graduates underemployed, the issues surrounding today's economic uncertainty are critically important to me and to my generation. So, with this being the case, it begs the question, is the American dream dead? Tonight, we have an unbelievable panel with some of the most senior economic experts in the country to talk about this problem precisely. Joining us tonight is Chairman Furman, who is the current chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors at the White House. Previously, Chairman Furman served as the deputy director of the National Economic Council and was an economic advisor for the Hamilton Project at the Brookings Institute and at the World Bank. Joining us as well is former Chairman Austan Goolsbee, who is the Robert P. Gwynn Professor of Economics at the University of Chicago Booth School of Business, and previously served in Washington as the Chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors and a member of the President's Cabinet from 2010 to 2011. His research on technology industries and government policy have earned him recognition as a Fulbright Scholar and an Alfred P. Sloan Fellow. Megan McArdle is an economic journalist, a columnist for Bloomberg View, a graduate of the Booth School, and most importantly, a fall fellow here at the Institute of Politics. Mr. Carl has written for The Economist, The Atlantic, and Newsweek, and her seminar series entitled Inside the Policymaking Sausage Factory, What's Promised on the Campaign Trail and What Actually Makes Policy, will be held at the IOP House on Tuesdays at noon this next quarter. We also have Dr. Randall Krosner, who is the Norman R. Bovins Professor of Economics at Booth School of Business, and served as the governor of the Federal Reserve System from 2006 until 2009, chairing the Committee on Supervision and Regulation of Banking Institutions and the Committee on Consumer and Community Affairs. And tonight, our moderator is Annie Lowry. Ms. Lowry currently is a journalist for the New York Magazine reporting on politics and economic policy. Ms. Lowry has also contributed to the New York Times, Slate, The New Yorker, and Foreign Policy. As you can see, we have an incredible panel tonight. So, with that, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to thank you all for coming again and ask that you please join in welcoming tonight's panel.
Thank you very much for that introduction. Thanks, David, so much for inviting me. It's really exciting to be here in Chicago. A little challenging to get here sometimes, but it's certainly worth the trip. And thanks for starting with those slides. I actually didn't bring any of my own. You saved me from embarrassment because I would have had exactly the same slides with one exception, and in that exception I saved you from embarrassment. I would have done them all in logarithms, which is, anyway, we can discuss that. We're in a position now where the economic recovery is increasingly strengthening. We're not all the way out of the worst recession since the Great Depression, but we're getting there. The unemployment rate has fallen from a high of 10% down to 6.1%. Even if you include broader measures of unemployment that include discouraged workers or people that are marginally attached, people that would like to find a job but aren't looking anymore, you're about 80% of the way back to where you were prior to the recession. The pace of job growth has picked up, 215,000 jobs a month instead of the 194,000 a month last year. The participation rate has stabilized since the end of last year, and you've seen wage growth picking up. It had been growing at about a 2% rate. Now it's growing at about a 2.5% rate, which is somewhat above inflation, although still not enough to keep up with the productivity that David was showing you, let alone for making up with what we've seen in the past. As this recovery unfolds, though, it puts into deeper relief the set of really deep structural challenges that we had prior to the recession. And even if we had never gone into a downturn in 2007, we would have spent the last 7 years worried about, and we still would be worried about. They're problems and challenges that were decades in the making and that will take a while to deal with. To describe them and a little bit how I think about them and how we approach them, want to divide the post-war economic period into three groups of time. The first I'll call the Golden Age. It's from 1948 to 1973. And all three things that we care about for family incomes went right over that 25-year period. We saw very rapid productivity growth. It was a 2.8% annual rate. We saw inequality roughly stable. In fact, the share of income going to the bottom 90% of Americans rose a tiny bit over that time. And then another thing that's an engine for middle class incomes is labor force participation. And we saw women go from about one third of prime age women, that's age 25 to 54 working, to one half. The combination of those three things drove the incomes for the average incomes for the bottom 90% of households, and that's the best proxy for middle class we have that covers this whole period, drove them up at a 2.8% annual rate. A 2.8% annual rate means that the typical family's income would double every 25 years, which means once a generation, your income would double. starting around 1973, two out of those three things that had been driving middle-class incomes went off the tracks. Productivity growth slowed dramatically. It got cut in half from 2.8 to 1.4%. Inequality started rising. Over the period from 1973 to 1995, the share of income going to the bottom 90% fell from 68% to 59%. And the one thing that kept going was female labor force participation, rose from 50 to 75% over that period. That wasn't enough to make up for the slowdown in productivity and the rise in inequality. And if you look at that measure, the average income for the bottom 90%, it grew at minus 0.4% over that period. And if you do the math, that means it takes negative 175 years for your income to double. A big change from what we had seen before. Since 1995, one thing has gone partially right, and another thing has gone back in the other direction. The partially right is productivity growth has picked up, starting with the new economy, the internet, mobile broadband, and continuing through a range of other phenomena in terms of energy, health, and throughout our economy. Productivity growth has been growing at a 2.3% rate over this period. That's not quite as fast as those golden years post-World War II, but it's a lot faster than 1973 to 1995. Inequality, of course, continued to rise, and it rose at about the same rate that it was rising in those bad decades in the 70s and 80s. And then the one thing that went the other way was labor force participation helped at least salvage zero growth from 73 to 95. That stalled and started to reverse. And you've seen even prime age female labor force participation falling slightly as male labor force participation has continued its decline. Take all of that, and this measure of income growth has been a minus 0.2% annual rate since 1995. So we've gone from doubling over a generation to roughly flat over the course of a generation. To go back into those factors and give a sense of what matters for this and how much it matters, want to do two thought experiments. The first thought experiment is assume that productivity stayed on the same path it was on from 1948 to 1973. And assume also that all those gains were distributed equally. So we had the same rise in inequality we had, but all the extra income was shared in proportion to the way income is divided today. If we had done that, incomes today would be 69% higher than they actually had been if we had stayed on that post-war growth path. That translates into $36,000 for a household in the middle of the income distribution. So I think growth matters. The second experiment is let's now keep the growth rate constant so we have the same disappointing growth rate that we've seen since 1973. But now let's make our thought experiment freeze the income distribution at where it was in 1973. So the same aggregate gains, more of them going to the bottom 90%. Less of them going to the top 1%. Now, depending on what data series you use, you get between 18 and 31% higher incomes with just the same dismal growth rate, but no increase in inequality. That translates into nearly $10,000 for a household. If you do the two of these combined, if you had the earlier growth rates and froze inequality, you get compounding, so you don't just add those two, and you get $52,000. In other words, income in 2013 for the typical household would have been almost exactly double what it actually was. You know, what I personally take from that is that growth matters, that inequality matters, and that the combination of the two, if you can get them going in the right direction, is especially powerful. Now, one criticism you might say is that experiment on growth, if we had had those earlier growth rates and everything had been shifted up 69%, that would all gone to the top 1% or the top 1/10 of 1%. You know, can't know for sure. It's certainly possible that's the case. I think there's a very good chance a decent amount of that would have been spread out. And for those of you that pay a lot of attention to Thomas Piketty, one implication of his argument is that inequality depends on the difference between R and G. R is the rate of return to capital. It's what you get on inherited wealth, dividends, et cetera. And G is the rate of return, growth rate of the economy, which is roughly the rate of return to labor or wages. And he says when R minus G rises, that increases inequality. It tilts you towards wealth and inherited wealth. Well, if G rises in that same model, it would go the opposite way. And you would think it would tend to shift income towards labor, reducing inequality. Inequality, you often hear, well, you know, even if all the income were redistributed, it wouldn't make a massive difference. I think I just went through the arithmetic. Nearly $10,000 is, I think, a pretty large difference to a lot of people. So I think that helps frame an economic agenda, is that what's happened to incomes is both a fall off in growth, especially productivity growth, and a failure to capture the benefits of that growth. But I also want to mention that third ingredient, which is labor force participation. And this has gotten a lot of attention in the wake of the Great Recession. I think a lot of people know that the labor force participation rate has fallen by 3 percentage points since the end of 2007. And it's stabilized, as I said before, but it hasn't made any move to recovering. Some of that has to do with the recession. Some of that has to do with the aging of the population. But the more you look at it, the more it's hard not to think that a lot of that was a bigger trend going on in the economy for a longer time. For men, their participation in the labor force, prime age men, peaked in 1953 and has been falling continuously since then. For younger men, especially younger men of color, it can get below 50%. For women, it rose until the mid-90s, peaked, and then started falling. So at the same time that you've had the slowing of growth and this inequality, you've also had fewer ability for a two-earner couple, for example, to offset that, or someone working full-time, as we've also seen a rise in part-time unemployment. I think the flip side of participation is Janet Yellen, chair of the Federal Reserve, identified women's entry into the economy as the single largest force in economic growth in the second half of the 20th century. And what's so powerful about it is it's an inclusive force of growth. So if we could resume raising female labor force participation, get young men of color participating more in the economy, you don't just get higher output, you get a broader set of talent contributing to that output and being included in it. So I think growth, inequality, but also just participation in the economy itself are those three key ingredients, all of which were going right in the 50s and 60s, all of which to varying degrees have gone wrong in varying decades since then. In terms of the agenda, that means, first of all, everything that just affects the overall size of the economy, I think we should think of as a middle class issue and think of in this frame. So if corporate tax reform could increase our total factor productivity or increase the amount of capital that our workers have at their disposal, it'll help solve at least some of the problems David talked about. Infrastructure does double duty. It both increases your productivity, but it also helps bring more people into the workforce. Education probably does triple duty. It helps people become more productive. It can help bring more people into the workforce, and it can raise the returns for low and middle income people to some degree, reducing inequality. I don't think all of that will be enough. So steps that affect before-tax incomes, like raising the minimum wage, steps that affect after-tax incomes, like expanding the earned income tax credit for childless workers, which hopefully Paul Ryan, in his preseason appearance here, mentioned last week. It's an idea that he adopted from the president's proposal earlier this year, and we're very happy to see him do that. And then, finally, things that really focus on getting people into the workforce. So if you look again at that female labor force participation that I've mentioned a couple times, we were ahead of most European countries around 1990. Now we're behind everyone but Japan. And at the rate Japan's going, it'll actually catch up and exceed the United States in female labor force participation. So things like childcare, paid leave, workplace flexibility can all help bring more families into the economy. Now, I'm actually probably a little bit more optimistic than some of this tone conveyed. I think the United States has a lot of enormous strengths. We have strengths in education, the best universities in the world. You know, a lot of people talk about China, but there aren't a whole lot of people moving to China in order to invent things there. There's an awful lot of people moving from China and around the world here to the United States to contribute to our economy. We have, we're about to be the number one oil producer in the world. We're already the number one natural gas producer in the world. That's having important ramifications throughout our economy. Our health spending is the highest as a share of GDP in the world, which is not something I would treat as a bragging point, but the growth rate of it has slowed dramatically. It was double digits a decade ago. It's about 3% right now. I think that's also having a set of important economic effects. And then a lot of the things we're doing now, for example, historic increases in Pell Grant, opportunity to attend college, are things I would expect to see show up in a lot of the economic data we're looking at, you know, 5, 10, 15, 20 years from now. So a lot of this problem is one, and challenge is one that has taken decades to build up. The United States has a lot of strengths to confront this challenge with, and a lot of what we need to do now is both finish that economic recovery, but deal with these deeper underlying structural issues that the economy faces. And I think if we do that, we'll come back here and David will show us better charts the next time. Thank you.
For that. I appreciate, and I hope that you guys, I think everybody here just wants to hear you talk amongst yourselves, so please interrupt each other and interrupt me. But I want to start off by asking you a question, Jason, because you pointed to the data that seems to show that the recovery is maybe strengthening and growth is picking up, but we're not seeing that in wage growth. And in the big census report on family incomes in 2013, they were stagnant, despite the fact that there was some decent growth in 2012, 2013. So do you expect that some of this should start turning around if the economy gets stronger?
Yeah, so first of all, I underscore what you just said. That census report was about 2013, and we've had nearly a year of data since then. And we have seen real wages pick up in the last 12 months. They're up at 0.9 percentage points. Which is a lot faster than the roughly zero that had preceded that. So my expectation is that, combined with the increased pace of job growth in 2014, means that when we get the census numbers for 2014, unfortunately nearly a year from now, we'll see a healthier income growth. Even in those 2013 numbers, if you looked at families, so two or more related people together, you saw decent income growth. And you actually saw it almost all in women, not in men, so that earnings gap between them narrowed a little bit in 2013. You also saw in 2013 some improvements in poverty. The child poverty rate fell 1.9 percentage points, which was the largest single year decline in poverty in 47 years. So I think in some ways you were seeing that economy starting to work for people in those data, and I think we've seen more since then.
But it seems that, you know, even with growth coming back, I think that you pointed out that it seems that there are a lot of things that are still working against families, or at least not doing much to help families out. So I want to open it up to the panel as to how much, given that right now politics is a little bit frozen, whether there's anything on the horizon that we should be optimistic about, anything that you guys are looking at or seeing that might be turning around.
Let me start by saying that I see for many of you, this is your first IOP event you've ever been to. So you cannot properly fathom what has just happened at the start of this event with David Axelrod's presentation. He's brought a lot. The IOP has been a great success. But if I had told you at any time in the previous however many years that David Axelrod would be standing before us presenting median family income data, the change in the Gini coefficient, with totally understanding and following his material, you would not have believed it. You can see the influence that the University of Chicago has had on David Axelrod. And if in the next presentation he quotes Thucydides or the Peloponnesian War, his conversion to the dark side will be complete. And
but still, he doesn't get an A because it wasn't in logarithms. There's still more to do.
So, what is there to be binary? We don't have an engineering department, but now we do. We have a molecular engineering. But what is there to be optimistic about? In the next 12 months, not a tremendous amount. You know, Washington is not helping, I don't think. The rest of the world is not helping. We go through a bubble. We didn't have a V-shaped recovery, in my opinion, not primarily because we had a lot of leverage, but primarily because you can only have a V-shaped recovery if the economy can go back to doing what it was doing before the recession began, and here it fundamentally cannot. So we need more exports, we need more investment, we need more innovation, and all of those things have gotten more complicated and more difficult as the rest of the world is not doing that well. Now, that said, I think the reasons to be optimistic, and it's hard to be pessimistic once you start thinking about those reasons, the U.S. remains the most entrepreneurial of all the major economies, with the most skilled workforce of all the major economies. Our CEA people being who they were, as we would say that to the president, the CEA people came back and said, you kept telling the president, they put that line in the State of the Union. I said, that's great. They said, no, it's not great, because technically Luxembourg has higher productivity than we have. And they were offended that we sent in the suggested edit to the speechwriters. Their edit was, except for 250,000 workers in Luxembourg, we remain the highest productivity. And they received no answer from the speechwriters. They were offended. So I think entrepreneurship, skilled workforce, as well as the remarkable ability, not just of startups, not just in Silicon Valley, of big companies to reinvent themselves and find new things to do, those are reasons to be highly optimistic. The university system, optimistic. But all of these are not a 12-month kind of thing, I think.
Please.
I was going to say, part of the question is, this might be
done. Yeah, okay. So part of the question is, can a University of Chicago graduate remember to turn her mic on before she starts talking?
No.
Look, what's the baseline as part of it, right? Are we going to go back to the golden age? You know, my grandparents grew up, they didn't have running water, they did not have electricity, they didn't have central heat, and my grandparents lived for the first, until 1940, my grandparents lived in a room they rented from my grandfather's parents, in which they literally, like, because I believe the Chinese symbol for trouble is two women in one kitchen.
They were an international house?
No, they literally cut a hole in the wall, put their stovepipe through, and that's where they lived for the first 7 years of their marriage.
They lived in the stovepipe?
No, in the room with the stovepipe cut in the wall. And to go to that, from that to their three-bedroom house with a bathroom and a half, I mean, that was a major, right, constant improvement in lifestyle. You almost can't do that again, right? What's the transformation we're going to do from having to go out back in the Syracuse winter to use the bathroom at 3 a.m. There's never going to be a comparable transition in future life unless it's like we just live forever as computer brains or something, right? So that experience of just expecting that every 10 or 20 years you're going to be twice as rich as your parents were is not necessarily a realistic expectation, certainly in terms of lived experience. So, but is the baseline, I think in a lot of ways, money is the wrong measure. Like money is a problem, don't get me wrong, money buys many useful things. But the things that worry me more are things like insecurity. This inability to think that I'm going to have a job where I have an expectation that I can have that job for 20 or 30 years, that it will pay me well, that they won't fire me, or they won't schedule me for 20-hour shifts, that I will be able to schedule some sort of reasonable childcare for my children and not be told that like last week's arrangement doesn't work anymore because now you're on nights. Those sorts of things, the relative loss of status that accompanied the loss of manufacturing, and I look at the larger trends that drove that, things like trade, immigration, automation, none of which I want to shut down, none of which anyone wants to shut down, but which for the next 10 to 20 years look like they may well, as they did early in the Industrial Revolution, dominate the improvements in technology, right? In the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, a lot of people are getting poorer in terms of how, you know, you take the craftsmen of 1770, their grandchildren are living less well than they were in 1820. That's, I think, a problem to negotiate. On the long term, I'm completely optimistic because America is hugely entrepreneurial, although getting less so. We have a very skilled workforce, although in a lot of ways those skills are stalling. I think the question is, can we manage something that looks and feels to people in the middle class like their lives are improving? Even if it isn't like, you know, my parents couldn't afford to have more than a cold water flat in Brooklyn and I live in a nice house in the suburbs, whatever it is, now they're back in the cold water flats in Brooklyn. But those things, even if it isn't that big a transition, can we manage a state where people feel like their lives are improving steadily? And I actually think that we can. But I think that it's going to require a lot of cultural and economic shifts that we haven't yet. So I guess I'm a little more pessimistic probably than the rest of the panel.
So I share the long run optimism of the other speakers, but I'm probably not as optimistic in the short run as Austan was. If you look at small business formation, it's been astonishingly low in this recovery. And that's something that worries me a little bit about the entrepreneurial spirit in the US. Labor force participation has dropped quite significantly, as Jason had said. And in particular, it's dropped a lot for younger workers. Now, part of that is because younger people are staying in school longer, so there's more education. So in the long run, that can have some positive impacts. But in the short run, we've seen a significant drop, 7-8% for males, and not quite as much, but significant for females. People are staying at home, not forming new households. It's another thing that has been unusual about this recession, the very low rate of household formation. And this worries me. Now, some people say, well, it's the millennial generation, and so people want to share, and they don't want to own. And so obviously you guys can decide that because you're part of that generation. Maybe, but maybe they don't feel that the opportunities are there. This is also something that's quite concerning because, you know, we sometimes talk about older workers or prime age workers that it's much more difficult to retool and to change their skill set. But younger workers should be able to do that quite easily, and people just coming into labor force should be able to do that. But we've seen very low entry at that stage. That concerns me quite a bit. As I said, very low small business formation concerns me quite a bit. And so, I think in the long run we do have the broader entrepreneurial spirit, the broader flexibility in the U.S. economy. And my guess is we will be doing better than many of our brothers and sisters around the world, particularly Europe. But in the short term, immediate run, I think we're facing some really major challenges.
I think that's right. I think we will do better than other countries. It's just that not that like China, right, is going to be growing faster than us, but like than other developed countries in our class, we have long done better than them, and I think we will continue to, but that's not necessarily the bar that we hoped we would be clearing.
And I think a big part of that better than them, if you look at productivity growth, you know, average over 15 or 20 years, it's been declining since the end of World War II in all of Europe and in Japan. They had this big boost at the end of the war as they recovered, and it's just been getting worse and worse ever since. For us, it looked a lot like that, and then 1995 and the 90s and internet, computer, a lot of which is right here in the United States, happened. And our productivity growth actually started rising while everyone else's continued to decline. You add to that that our cyclical recovery has been a lot stronger than most of the other developed countries. And you know, I go to meetings that Austan used to go to at the OECD and elsewhere. And you know, whatever amount of you know negativity about the short run Randy would share with us here, you get there and everyone's just like, how can we be like the United States? We want to be more like you. We're counting on you know your growth to help drive our economy. I do think you know the question of baselines is an important one, but there's a lot of numbers between the minus 0.2 growth that we've seen since 95 and the 2.8% that we saw when you know your grandparents were getting flush toilets, which I think is still a little bit less exciting than an iPhone 6. But you know, to each their own tastes. But you know, there's a lot of numbers between those two. So yes, maybe we can't get back, you know, the aspiration to having a 1950s economy is a little bit, you know, behind in a lot of different ways. But you know, we're not going to have better security if you don't have you know, better income growth.
Well, I just want to say that my column tomorrow is going to be titled, you know, 10 ways that a flush toilet is better than an iPhone 6.
You know, I would say this.
And you know that from your experience in business.
You would never. I don't even want us to go there. Just leave it. Just leave it. I would never get us into a debate about price indices at an event like this, but we need to have a discussion about price indices because all the when the economists want to have an argument about are we better off as a median family better off than they were before. Part of the thing is, well, is the median family different? They have fewer kids. And then the other is, well, how much does stuff cost? So you make $50,000, but how much does it cost to buy the same thing? And there's a famous book on economic growth, which begins with King, I don't make up the names because I don't remember, but King Leopold the 50th, who's the richest man in the world in like 1300, and he's counting his money, and he drops the lid of one of his chests on his finger, and it cuts his finger, and he gets an infection, and he dies from a thing which for 50 cents today you could take antibiotics and you'd be cured. And so the question is King Leopold III, who's the richest man in the world in 1300, poorer than the poorest person in the United States
Calvin
today?
Coolidge's son died of, he went up to play tennis, I guess wearing loafers, got a blister and he died.
He sounds like he deserved it.
But I mean, this was in 1924. This
yes,
wasn't
but so
even
that, that question of, if you have an iPhone 6 or antibiotics or, you know, I won't say our music is better, you know, than it was in the big band era. But look, there are all of these new forms of entertainment that did not exist, and somehow you got to take that into account. And one of our now deceased but great Nobel laureates, Robert Fogel, wrote this book in which he said, let's look at what people have spent their time doing during the day from sometime when it was like from 1400 up to 2000, and then let's extrapolate forward. And the number one thing that we do now, that we don't do now, that we used to do, is we used to work all day long. People worked 16 hours a day, 7 days a week. There were no vacations, there were no break. And so a lot of what has happened has been an increase in leisure time, leisure activities, and entertainment. And that stuff continues, and it is worth something. It's just how do we embody that into real incomes. I don't know how we do it.
It's one of my favorite ways to describe precisely the phenomenon that you're talking about is the Louis C.K. joke where he's like, everything's amazing and nobody's happy. Right? That describes the modern economy. And it's true. But it says something problematic if one of the primary, if not possibly, perhaps arguably, the primary way in which middle class life is getting better is that stuff is getting cheaper and awesomer.
Yeah, but like,
that's bad.
But, I mean, you look across what's country.
Why is that bad? Yeah.
It's a lot of stuff isn't getting cheaper, right?
No, but now we're back to the fight about price indices. Okay, so is it getting cheaper? Is it not getting cheaper? A bunch of stuff is cheaper.
Right.
So we found my old ColecoVision. You remember before there ever was a Game Boy, there was this little, you were a dot, you were a football dot, and you could go up and you would do a dot.
Pong.
I would sit and play
That's
that thing.
Pong.
I would sit and play that thing for hours. And I showed my kids and they're like, what the hell is this? They didn't say it that way, but they're like, dots, give me a break. They're like, give me a break. This is horrible. And at a time when there were three channels of on television, it was worse. It was people can watch. They can waste more time watching TV now than they ever have in the past.
But it's not just that. I mean, it's
yes.
How long you live and the quality of your life.
Sure.
Yes.
It's class sizes are smaller, the average home is larger. I mean, a lot of the different, more fundamental, more important things are better. And I think
you gotta be careful. We got a bunch of U of C graduates and they're like, that golden era was in the past. You know, it's worse.
But the other thing too is like everyone complains, right? But complaining is what writing is, right? No one writes that they're like, hey, my life is awesome. I was just thinking about how awesome everything is, the end, right? Like all writing is basically about complaining about something. And so people complain. You look at literature from the 50s and the 60s. What are they complaining about? Everything's boring. We just work with these steady jobs that never go away, and everyone's being subsumed. And like people complain. I think if you look at things like, especially with what women were doing, you look at like what it took to do the laundry before washing machines. It was an all-day. So you look at ads from the 30s. It's one of my favorite examples of this. A lot of the ads for like laundry soaps talk about that Monday evening feeling. Now, what the hell is a Monday evening feeling, right? And I'm reading this, finally I realized by parsing enough of them, because people did their wash on Monday, it was the total exhaustion of having spent 16 hours boiling water repeatedly and putting every piece of cloth in the house into the water and then lifting the completely sopping, not spun dry by your washing machine, things out and putting them into another container so you could rinse them with the cold water and then taking them out again and wringing them out so you could then hang them on a line. And that took all day, and by the end of the day, it was the worst day of your week because you were physically completely exhausted and that had been your Monday. And that, like, we've totally lost that. That never showed up in any statistics anywhere, because it wasn't being measured, because it wasn't part of GDP, but it was an enormous improvement. Now, a lot of women have poured that effort. If you look at time use surveys, they're pouring it back into spending time on their kids, and it doesn't seem to make them very happy. they don't seem to enjoy, let me put that another way. They do not seem to enjoy very much the amount of time that they're spending going to mommy and me classes or having enrichment programs or driving everyone to soccer. But it's something, so like, are they happier? They're investing more in their kids, and they're spending more time with their family. And that's basically supposed to be the goal, right? Is that you get to spend more time with your family building relationships instead of hauling sopping wet bundles of fabric from container to container.
I like that the first half of this panel was to completely and utterly depress you about the structural forces that are crushing American families, and the second half is to reassure you that it's all really fabulous regardless.
That it could be much worse.
It could be much vastly worse. Let's go back to David's chart. Because the other thing, we've been somewhat backward-facing, but being forward-facing, I think that there's sometimes a sense that there are these tidal economic forces, and there's nothing that we can do to reverse them, that they have, you know, pushed against economic policy, that despite our best efforts to have a better educated, more productive workforce, that they're still really hit. But I think that fatalism, when you talk to policymakers on both sides, is perhaps not merited. And there are things, and you pointed to some of them. So what's the what do you think? Are the tangible things that need to be done now to help, if not return things to how they were before the 70s to bring them back so that they're at least headed more in the right direction as that growth increases.
Right. I mean, you've heard my list and, or more importantly, the president's list. And, you know, what's striking about that is so many of those ideas are really ones that have a strong bipartisan lineage. And I think I actually didn't include immigration, but I should have. And infrastructure, business tax reform, education, as I said, childless EITC, you know, even in the past, the minimum wage, frankly. I mean, all of these are issues that should have bipartisan support. Whether or not they do and on what time scale they do is obviously a very different question than that one.
Mm-hmm. So I agree with your list, except for the minimum wage. And because I really think that's a misfocus. EITC, which provides income support for people and incentives for people to work, I think is something very valuable. And it is very important to try to do something for people who are low income. So I don't want to suggest that I'm not interested in having some sort of government support for that. But I just think the minimum wage is, particularly in the context of what I was talking about earlier, of very low labor force participation by younger workers, particularly lower skilled workers, because that's really where the minimum wage is binding. So the vast majority of workers who are at minimum, I shouldn't say the vast majority, a significant fraction of workers who are minimum wage workers are middle class kids who are starting out in the workforce, or lower skilled people who are just entering the workforce. By raising the minimum wage, it makes it more difficult for them to get into the workforce. A lot of controversy on what the employment effects are, but I think it's reasonably clear for at least that group that it's particularly challenging to get into the workforce. And I think one of the things we want to do is try to get people into the workforce rather than coming out of the workforce. Second is that the incidence of the additional costs, because there are some additional costs in some areas of paying the workers more, that tends to fall on lower income people. Why is that? Because the minimum wage workers tend to be in things like fast food. As a percentage of the consumption basket of lower income people, they tend to spend more on consumption goods that are produced by people who are at the minimum wage. So the incidence tends to be more on the lower income people than on higher income people. And so it just strikes me as it's just not the right way to focus things. I can understand the motivation for it, but I think it's not only an inefficient way, but I think a negative way to try to address the issues, particularly now we have so many younger people who are not in the labor force.
Sure. I was going to stipulate my disagreement, but let me explain it a little bit. If you look, the Congressional Budget Office did something on the minimum wage, and I think there's a whole bunch of issues in what they did and don't accept the numbers, but let's just stipulate them for the moment. According to them, you had 24 million people getting a raise. That was about 100 times larger than the number of people that they had adversely affected. They also looked at Randy's question, which was the financing of it, and again, with a very adverse assumption on the financing of the minimum wage increase, that none of it would manifest itself in terms of higher productivity, reduced turnover, and the types of things that I think explain the evidence on why we see little to no employment effect. But even assuming none of those, taking into account their financing, on net, I don't remember the exact numbers anymore, but it's something like a $20 billion a year annual gain for the below 300% of poverty, something, I could be way off, but it's some number like that. Equivalent of a tax cut of hundreds of billions of dollars over the next decade. And I think part of that is, Randy, I mean, I think you look a few decades ago, it was actually disproportionately teenagers and, a child of, Greg Mankiw told me, when I was on the minimum wage, and uses that as his example, I looked it up. When he was on the minimum wage, 30% of people were like him. Now it's more like 10% of people like him. So it's actually changed a lot and become more low income, more, less teenager, somewhat older group. And I think that combined with the evidence on employment, combined with even if you don't believe a lot of that evidence on employment, it's still a distributional positive and a positive for low-income families think me think it's a good part of a solution.
Although I think you do have to also consider what the distributional benefit is versus the distributional cost, because being unemployed for the long term is about the worst thing that can happen to you in a Western democracy, short of death or dismemberment. It is, when you look at the effects on people's happiness, it's the only thing people don't recover from. They recover from being paralyzed, they recover from being widowed, from being divorced. The one thing they never get happier about is being unemployed. 5 years later, they're still just as unhappy as they were when they lost their job. And so if you say, I believe the numbers were 24 million and got a raise and 900,000 would, I could be wrong about this because I'm working from memory, but if you look at that 500, it was either 500 or 900,000 people.
500,000,
right? So you look at those 500,000 people who now don't have jobs. Are they, is the fact that they don't have a job at all and are completely unemployed, out of the labor market, not gaining skills, not gaining any potential entry to any other sort of job, is making 500,000 people worse off to give 24 million people a small raise? And we don't know what the total magnitude of each. You're looking at the worst off people are a lot worse off. And you see this a lot with welfare stuff, right? It's like welfare reform seems to have made most of the people on welfare less poor, but then it made a core of people much, much poorer than they have been. And those sorts of questions, I think, get really, really difficult.
Yeah. Right. I mean, first of all, you've had a lot of good economists take a look at that and think that greatly overstates the employment effects, and we could, go into
even if you don't think that,
this group of people permanently gets a raise of like 2,000-4,000 a year, which is not nothing, and these people are permanently unemployed, you still have people cycling around. And so I don't think you want to think, yeah. Some people can spend times in both of those states.
We just had a paper come through the seminar series here that I believe is coming out in the JP, which would challenge some of the things that you're saying, that it still is, that a very significant fraction is still not poor people who would be directly affected by it, or that would benefit directly from it. Many of my colleagues have a different view of the employment employment impacts, and so we have a number of people who are our colleagues who would suggest that the employment impacts are larger. I think what was said was exactly right. You have to worry about the longer term impacts of these people not coming into the labor force or not being able to get a job. And as I said, I think it's particularly problematic now with such low labor force participation by younger people, that's going to slow things down, and we really want to get these people in. So I think the data are I think not quite as clear as what Jason was saying. This other paper suggests that these incidence issues are really quite significant today, and as well as the who is being affected by it. But I think for me, I don't think we have the data on this yet, but just seeing the low labor force participation by young people and the costs of not coming into the labor force being so high, it just seems like an ineffective way to do it. There are other ways like the EITC that you talked about, which strike me as a much more effective way to try to get to the same goal in a much more effective way.
Yeah, and I was just going to interject a note that one reason I'm very happy that we're having this debate, as academic as it can be and longstanding as the disagreements about this are, is that this is actually happening, right? Not at a federal level, but I think it's something like 36 states have already or are considering raising their minimum wages, along with a lot of cities and localities. It's going to affect a huge number of workers, whereas a lot of what we're talking about is more blue sky thinking, what can we do? Because I don't think corporate tax reform is passing anytime soon.
Right. And I do thank you, because a big part of our approach was we want Congress to act, but also encouraging states, cities. You've seen businesses like The Gap. And then we've acted as well in terms of federal contractors and requiring them to pay $10.10 an hour. And if you look in total, 8 million people have gotten a raise because of those actions, or are in train to get a raise because of those actions taken since the president first called for it. So you'd get, by our numbers, 28 million if Congress acted. But based on what we've seen so far, you're at 8 million. So
if I can,
it shows you a lot of that action, trying to encourage action at the state and local level and importance of it.
I would also, though, like to plug blue sky things, because I think you need to have something to focus on that's a little bit aspirational. And I think that I would like to see a renewed focus on labor market connection, on maintaining them. I proposed, it never, surprisingly, when a journalist, a columnist at Bloomberg View proposed something, never went anywhere in Congress. But like, you could, you know, you could rebate the payroll tax 1 month for every month that someone's been unemployed, right? And give people a marginal incentive to hire people, make those workers slightly cheaper, and give people some incentive to put people who've been out of work for a long time back to work. You could have temporary government jobs that aren't real, you know, like aren't real government jobs that aren't, but something like the WPA. It's, I mean, the barriers to that are enormous, right? They're absolutely crazy enormous when you think about the public sector unions and all the civil service rules and so forth. But you could think about something like that. And you could also, I really like to think see us think about deregulation, because I was talking, not just sort of blanket deregulation, but I was talking to a very nice progressive economist who left progressive economist world to start a business and then went back to progressive economist world, because he said he actually couldn't, he was in this like this Heisenbergian state of uncertainty about everything. Like, he had to hire someone to do his payroll because it was not possible for him to do it correctly. He also didn't know if they were doing it correctly, but at least like he'd transferred some of the liability, but they would charge him for stuff and he'd be like, I guess that's right. He had no way to, this is a guy with a PhD who's a very smart guy. And that this is generally, when you talk to business owners, like, it's not by any means the only thing. It makes me crazy when conservatives are like, just cut taxes for business and like cut regulation and then everything's fine. That's obviously not the case, but it is the case that when you talk to small business owners, the amount of uncertainty surrounding what they are and aren't allowed to do, and it's federal, it's state, it's local, and often those things can conflict and so forth, is enormous, and that it is, it makes them frightened to do things and to expand. And it isn't even that these are bad regulations. It's just that like complexity doesn't add geometrically. It multiplies, it doesn't add arithmetically. It multiplies geometrically, right? Like every time you add a new node, the number of potential interactions just keeps growing exponentially. And it's at the point where no one feels like they can know what the relevant law is. And that's different from other countries. It's really funny when you talk to like Swedish people about business regulation. They're like, no, the safety regulators are nice. They can, you know, I want it to be safe too. And it's very collaborative. And it's not this kind of endless, rule-based, incessantly multiplying craziness of regulation. And we could aspire to something like that. It's not like the Swedes have the magic good regulation gene and we don't. at least I certainly hope not. But so we could think about something like a regulatory budget, where every time you enact a new regulation, another one has to go away. Right, just because you're trying to minimize the complexity and you have to have priorities. But we don't make priorities about regulation, and every group has their own priorities. And the fact that every time you add seven new things, you're making it more complicated to own a business, to start a business, to innovate, just never gets counted in the cost. And you know, so instead of trying to focus on cost-benefit analysis of specific regulations, I would like to see us say, okay, like, look, this might be a good thing to do, but we can't have any more regulations and this thing is more important, rather than this is a good thing to do, let's do that, and not think about all of the other ways in which business is already burdened.
Yeah, and go ahead, Austan.
No, I was gonna, I didn't, it looked like somebody was waiting to answer a question.
Well, one last thing, because I like this thought. So really quickly, Randy and Austan, if you had your king for a day moment and you were gonna implement your blue sky, your single blue sky policy that was gonna help the middle class, what would it be? I think we got your laundry list.
Look, the fight about short term things pales completely. If you take a step back, what's totally obvious at the individual level, the city level, the state level, and the national level, is those places that had more training and have a higher skill base did better in the recession, are richer, have lower unemployment, have better outcomes on every possible measure. So I don't see how that, everything that we can put into the upping the skill base of the American workforce is not the number one thing. And even if you think about regulation or you think about taxes, you have to have a mental explanation for why places like Silicon Valley are in California, which has never, ever been anything other than a high regulation, high tax state. And the answer of why it's there is because the human capital is there. That's where the people are, and that's why they went there. And it isn't on the island of Vanuatu, where I understand there's no taxation of any kind. You had no corporate taxes, no individual tax. Sometimes I'll say that to business people, like, where is this island of Vanuatu? You know, so,
it does remind me there was one study which found regulation was really bad for economic growth. The United States had a lot of it. And you looked at their measure of regulation, and the best country in the world on their measure, Somalia.
Exactly. That's kind of my thing, is that, you know, you can make an exception. We live in the city of Chicago. Basically, we have very good rule of law. Your property rights are protected. You don't have to worry that, hey, we opened a factory, and then our workers woke up the next day and stole the blueprint and opened a factory across the street. And all of that stuff is supremely important for business climate. And so I think I would be dumping every amount of money, as well as just telling people, go get more skills. Just look at how people are doing who got the skills. They're doing a lot better. And so it makes me super worried. I think we have a tendency, all people have a tendency in a crisis, that the first thing you cut is the investments. So you say, oh, we can't afford that. That's some long-term thing. We're in a crisis right now. And we're in this perpetual crisis mode. We did things like, okay, well, as part of the sequester, let's cut financial aid, let's cut research and development spending, and let's cut a bunch of stuff to science and the National Institutes of Health. I think that's crazy. I think that's exactly the wrong thing if you wanna reset the middle class.
So I very much share the view that you wanna focus on G, you wanna focus on growth, because that's really the key for dealing with all of these issues. If we are not having economic growth, inequality becomes a second order issue. If just everyone is very poor, or the vast majority of people are poor, not making progress. And so education and building skills are incredibly important. So I certainly agree with that. Being a University of Chicago professor, we might say that that's sort of talking our book, because why not have the government spend more money on University of Chicago? So you have to be a little bit careful when professors say that, you know, spend more on education. So we take that
we
with a grain of
salt. Also use more journalism.
Journalism,
yeah.
yes.
lots more journalism.
I'm fully in support of that.
But certainly the studies do suggest there are very high returns to education, at least now, and so there's a lot of value for you guys being here, as well as for people in who are in middle school and high school. Having improvements there can be an enormous benefits, because not everyone is able to go to a four-year college. But trying to improve basic kindergarten to 12 education is incredibly important. And obviously, we're quite far behind in that compared with many of our brethren around the world. So I would put that as at least as high a priority as sort of university and college level skill improvement. And I would put more emphasis on the tax system and the incentives associated with that. I think we have just a crazy system that is driving U.S. companies to move abroad for no good reason, except we have a system that's not consistent with the rest of the world and giving people incentives to move abroad, and so even reduce the amount of taxes that are being paid in the U.S. By these corporations who are now doing their operations abroad. In the old days, the U.S. could get away with the tax system that it had because U.S. corporations were primarily generating revenue in the U.S. The U.S. is not as large as a fraction of the world as it once was, and so it's U.S. corporations' operations abroad are a much larger fraction of their total revenues and total profits, and we have to acknowledge that. We have to understand that. Also, as I mentioned, entrepreneurship seems to be not very strong right now because we're having very low small business formation. We have to think about ways in which we can reduce, whether it's taxes or the incentives of taxes, whether it's reduce some of the regulations that make it difficult for entrepreneurs to flourish, and focus on that. And so I think education, especially at the K-12 area, and thinking about the incentives of the tax system, both for large corporations and small corporations, would probably be my two priorities.
So thanks so much, and we're gonna, if anybody from the audience has questions, we're gonna have time for a couple of them. And there's a microphone, I apologize, I should have explained. There's a microphone right there.
Now, if you want, maybe we could gather a few questions and then answer them as a group.
Yeah, maybe that makes sense. Maybe we'll take like two or three and then.
Yeah,
and then
because if everyone chimes in, we'll
the panelists
get to many questions.
Will be ready to
wow.
respond.
They're leaving. They're not lining up for questions. They're leaving.
No. I think the line is getting long.
Yeah. Okay, go right ahead since we're...
Just wanted to thank you all for coming here. And I was wondering, I've tried to keep abreast about the economic recovery, and one thing I often read was that a lot of the jobs that have been formed are low-skill and low-paid jobs, and a lot of those jobs that are simply not coming back. Construction, a lot of factory jobs are going overseas, and a lot of the solution to the fact that there's just been this exodus of good-paying jobs has been to increase like manufacturing or increase new industries. Like Germany has been often hailed as an example of this sort of economic powerhouse that's still doing well in this bad recession. And I was wondering, is job training, like, has the data supported it being like a very effective way to retool these workers? Are factory workers going to be able to move to new industries and healthcare? Is this does the data just support that job training can be a good tool to like help improve the middle class?
Okay, so let's take some more questions. Yeah. Thank you so much. Go ahead.
So we talked a lot about productivity sort of in the aggregate, but I wanted to go back to that first graph where we saw productivity rising but median family income not rising with it. And I think this is sort of often raised in the context of like worker bargaining power, and are we somehow entering a world where workers are becoming more productive but not sharing the gains of it? But what seems to me a simpler story for that graph is just a mean versus a median. So like the productivity mean might be rising a lot if we have some sort of superstar effect where a few people are becoming really productive, and the median might be not rising a lot. So I guess this leads to like two possible stories. One where we have median worker productivity rising and for some reason they're not sharing the gains of that as much, or one where productivity at the median is actually stagnant. And so I guess the second story strikes me as more convincing, but I'm curious to hear what you guys have to think about that and sort of why we see this gap.
Okay. John, why don't I, those two are so
let's
related.
Let's see the third, because those two were related.
Great. Yeah.
Hi, thanks for the great conversation. That was really interesting. I heard a lot of praise about education, and I agree completely. I'm in school now, so it's a good thing for me, too. And you guys talked a lot about how education is makes you very optimistic about the future. But I have a question about another trend that I've been hearing a lot recently. That's about student debt. You know, I heard recently that student debt passed like $1 trillion or something like that. Yeah. So how does that affect your outlook for the future? How does that affect your optimism and pessimism? And what do you think can be done about it? That's my question. Thank you.
Okay. I'll turn it over to you guys.
In terms of the two questions that were actually related, yes, the thing you're seeing in that graph is productivity is a mean. The income numbers were a median. And when means and medians diverge, that's another way of saying inequality increase. That's actually one way to measure inequality, is the difference between those two. There's inequality at different parts of the spectrum. So if you're looking at the top 0.1%, then maybe something like superstars or norms or globalization is a big part of the story. But if you look something like the ratio of the 90th percentile to the 10th percentile, those factors are less important. And if you look for the last 100 years of data, that ratio is the almost exact mirror image of the amount of unionization there is in the economy. So as unions expanded, that ratio compressed. As unions contracted, that ratio grew. So I do think there's enough of a phenomenon, and it's varied enough, that technology is part of the story, globalization is part of the story, norms are part of the story, but certainly changing institutions, the decline of unions, the decline of the real value of the minimum wage is a part of that story. And I think that's related to the job quality question. You've seen a longstanding polarization of jobs, losing jobs in the middle, more at either end. Over time, that's tilted more towards adding jobs at the bottom and not adding them as much at the top, or the middle. I think a lot of the job quality discussion misses what's going on within each category of jobs. So if you see a shift towards a certain type of job, but each type of job is paying more than the past, wages might be going up despite the shift. That's why I prefer to just look at the monthly numbers on wages. And as I said, those aren't growing at a rate one can be satisfied with, but they're growing at a faster rate than they were growing before and growing faster than inflation. That tells me sort of all in, you know, you're seeing some improvements in that direction. But, you know, the gradient for education is, as everyone here has said, enormously clear. And I think that's important. Now those can get to the student debt. But that's important when thinking about that debate. A big part of why student debt has gone up is more people are going to college and more lower income people are going to college. And you have a debt for the typical person that has it is $24,000 a year. A return to school that's $15,000, I'm sorry, $24,000 in total. A return to school that's $15,000 per year. And you know that says for you, school is an overwhelmingly good deal. There's a large tail for which that's not true. Those are people going to schools who aren't completing, who are ending up with all the debt without the degree, without the higher wages. And at, you know, for-profit schools, you have a something like a 30% default rate for people that don't finish. So I think you know, we want to be concerned about debt. We don't want it to let it get in the way of what is an overwhelmingly good deal for college. But we want to worry especially about completing college, about lower quality colleges, and what we can do about that lower tail especially.
Yeah, I think the speaking as someone who first of all got an MBA and then became a journalist, and so is familiar with the large amounts of debt on these small amounts of salary problem. And also I went to training at a for-profit school. I'm probably the only person in this room who can say that. And I paid for it on a credit card, of all places. But that said, it's an overblown problem, right? When you look at the distribution, what you're seeing is there's a problem with people who didn't complete, especially people who didn't complete professional school. It is a terrible, terrible, terrible idea. Do not go to law school unless you're very, very sure you're going to finish, because dropping out in your second year is a ruinously expensive thing to do. But in general, it's not a large problem. The people who have large amounts of debt also have large amounts of income to pay it. There are obviously people in the New York Times who show up and have these terrible debts they can't pay. But like, you can't have
I found one of them.
Yeah. I was one of them. When I was 32, I was living in a tiny apartment and eating ramen and cheese doodle surprise, where the surprise is that you're 32 and eating ramen and cheese doodles for dinner.
But really enjoying the heat.
Right, yeah, it was very warm. I think the job training, James Heckman actually told me, I asked James Heckman about Germany specifically, and he said, Germany is good and bad. It's great if you're a 16-year-old who doesn't want to go to college. They're very good at getting you into a manufacturing job. It works really well. Part of it, though, is like cultural capital that's hard to replicate here. So Mark Kleiman, who's a bubble gall expresser at Chicago, tells a story about going to a banquet in Germany. And one of the guys who had been expected to see, it was a small town in Germany, who'd been expected, was the head of the local apprentice program, had expected to sit high on the little U that they had, and instead got seated at the bottom. And he was furious, and he walked up and he was like, "And what's going on?" And they said, "I think we all know how people did on the apprenticeship exams this year, right? Like, that wouldn't happen in America, where like your company's apprentices didn't do well, so there you are at the bottom and no one's speaking to you anymore in your little town." But also that when people, and what happens in Germany is there's no reentry point. So you get out and you're really well trained for a job, and then if that job goes away, you're hosed. And now I'm quoting Heckman. I have not done direct research, but he seems like a smart kind of guy who knows a lot about training programs. So I'm willing to take his word on it. And that's actually a big issue that you have. America's really, really good at reentry. We're not good at like pushing people through the funnel. And I kind of worry that our higher education system is starting to look a lot more like European systems, where like at the age of 8, you need to be worried about getting you to a good middle school, because if you're not in a good middle school, God knows your life is over, because you haven't prepared for like the 90 years of credentialing that you're going to need in order to get a decent job. We didn't used to look like that. It used to be actually relatively easy for people to flunk out and go back and do something else. And we're changing, and that worries me. So I wouldn't like to see us move towards more of a German system. And I think I'll repeat what Jason said, is that it's obviously partly superstar effect, right? Like, basketball players are just worth more than they used to be because they get aired all over the world. And their games and used to play locally and you watch them, and if no one went, then there wasn't that much revenue, and ESPN changed all that. But that's just a way of restating that they might be more productive, right? The 90% might be more productive. But it's still going to show up in a radical difference in equality in society, and people don't like that, and it makes them unhappy.
So I think that that is all the time that we have. Thank you, everybody, for coming. Thank you so much to our panelists. Thank you to David.
Thank you, Anne.
Wait a minute. I thought we still had 10 minutes.
Okay, so is it getting cheaper? Is it not getting cheaper? A bunch of stuff is cheaper.
Right.
So we found my old ColecoVision. You remember before there ever was a Game Boy, there was this little, you were a dot, you were a football dot, and you could go up and you would do a dot.
Pong.
I would sit and play
That's
that thing.
Pong.
I would sit and play that thing for hours. And I showed my kids and they're like, what the hell is this? They didn't say it that way, but you know, they're like, dots, give me a break. They're like, give me a break. This is horrible. And at a time when there were three channels of on television, it was worse. It was people can watch, they can waste more time watching TV now than they ever have in the past.
But I also think,
but it's not just that. I mean, it's
yes,
it's, you know, how long you live and the
yes,
quality
yeah,
of
yeah,
your
yeah,
life.
Sure.
Yes,
it's class sizes are smaller. The average home is larger. I mean, a lot of the different, more fundamental, more important things are better. And I
you
think got to
be
hard.
Careful. We got a bunch of U of C graduates, and they're like, that golden era was in the past. You know, that's worse.
But the thing, too, is like everyone complains, right? But complaining is what writing is, right? No one writes, they're like, hey, my life is awesome. I was just thinking about how awesome everything is, the end, right? Like, all writing is basically about complaining about something. And so people complain. You look at literature from the 50s and the 60s. What are they complaining about? Everything's boring. We just work with these steady jobs that never go away, and everyone's being subsumed. And like, people complain. I think if you look at things like, especially with what women were doing, you look at like what it took to do the laundry before washing machines. It was an all-day, so you look at ads from the 30s, one of my favorite examples of this, is they all, a lot of the ads for like laundry soaps talk about that Monday evening feeling. Now what the hell is a Monday evening feeling, right? And I'm reading this, and finally I realized by parsing enough of them, because people did their wash on Monday, it was the total exhaustion of having spent 16 hours boiling water repeatedly and putting every piece of cloth in the house into the water and then lifting the completely sopping, not spun dry by your washing machine, things out and putting them into another container so you could rinse them with the cold water and then taking them out again and wringing them out so you could then hang them on a line, and that took all day, and by the end of the day, it was the worst day of your week because you were physically completely exhausted and that had been your Monday. And that, like, we've totally lost that. That never showed up in any statistics anywhere, because it wasn't being measured, because it wasn't part of GDP, but it was an enormous improvement. Now, a lot of women have poured that effort. If you look at time use surveys, they're pouring it back into spending time on their kids, and it doesn't seem to make them very happy. they don't seem to enjoy, let me put that another way. They do not seem to enjoy very much the amount of time that they're spending going to mommy and me classes, or having enrichment programs, or driving everyone to soccer. But it's something, so like, are they happier? They're investing more in their kids, and they're spending more time with their family. And that's basically supposed to be the goal, right? Is that you get to spend more time with your family building relationships instead of hauling sopping wet bundles of fabric from container to
container.
I like
that the first half of this panel was to completely and utterly depress you about the structural forces that are crushing American families, and the second half is to reassure you that it's all really fabulous regardless.
That it could be much worse.
It could be much
yeah,
vastly worse.
Yeah,
there was, let's go back to David's chart. Because the other thing, we've been somewhat backward-facing, but being forward-facing, I think that there's sometimes a sense that there are these tidal economic forces, and there's nothing that we can do to reverse them, that they have, you know, pushed against economic policy, that despite, you know, that despite our best efforts to have a better educated, more productive workforce, that they're still really hit. But I think that that fatalism, when you talk to policymakers on both sides, is perhaps not merited. And there are things, and you pointed to some of them. So what's the what do you think? Are the tangible things that need to be done now to help, if not return things to how they were before the 70s, to bring them back so that they're at least headed more in the right direction as that growth increases?
Right. I mean, you heard my list,
yeah,
and or more importantly, the president's list. And you know what's striking about that is so many of those ideas are really ones that have a strong bipartisan lineage. And I think I actually didn't include immigration, but I should have. And infrastructure, business tax reform, education, as I said, childless EITC, you know, even in the past, the minimum wage, frankly. I mean, all of these are issues that should have bipartisan support. Whether or not they do and on what time scale they do is obviously a very different question than that one. Mm-hmm.
So I agree with your list, except for the minimum wage. And because I really think that's a misfocus. EITC, which provides income support for people and incentives for people to work, I think is something very valuable. And it is very important to try to do something for people who are low income. So I don't want to suggest that I'm not interested in having some sort of government support for that. But I just think the minimum wage is, particularly in the context of what I was talking about earlier, of very low labor force participation by younger workers, particularly lower skilled workers, because that's really where the minimum wage is binding. So the vast majority of workers who are at minimum, I shouldn't say the vast majority, a significant fraction of workers who are minimum wage workers are middle class kids who are starting out in the workforce, or lower skilled people who are just entering the workforce. By raising the minimum wage, it makes it more difficult for them to get into the workforce. A lot of controversy on what the employment effects are, but I think it's reasonably clear for at least that group that it's particularly challenging to get into the workforce. And I think one of the things we want to do is try to get people into the workforce rather than coming out of the workforce. Second is that the incidence of the additional costs, because there are some additional costs in some areas of paying the workers more, that tends to fall on lower income people. Why is that? Because the minimum wage workers tend to be in things like fast food. As a percentage of the consumption basket of lower income people, they tend to spend more on consumption goods that are produced by people who are at the minimum wage. So the incidence tends to be more on the lower income people than on higher income people. And so it just strikes me as it's just not the right way to focus things. I can understand the motivation for it, but I think it's not only an inefficient way, but I think a negative way to try to address the issues, particularly now we have so many younger people who are not in the labor force.
Sure. I was gonna stipulate my disagreement, but let me explain it a little bit. If you look, the Congressional Budget Office did something on the minimum wage, and I think there's a whole bunch of issues in what they did and don't accept the numbers, but let's just stipulate them for the moment. According to them, you had 24 million people getting a raise. That was about 100 times larger than the number of people that they had adversely affected. They also looked at Randy's question, which was the financing of it, and again, with a very adverse assumption on the financing of the minimum wage increase, that none of it would manifest itself in terms of higher productivity, reduced turnover, and the types of things that I think explain the evidence on why we see little to no employment effect. But even assuming none of those, taking into account their financing, on net, I don't remember the exact numbers anymore, but it's something like a $20 billion a year annual gain for the below 300% of poverty, something. I could be way off, but it's some number like that. Equivalent of a tax cut of hundreds of billions of dollars over the next decade. And I think part of that is, Randy, I mean, I think you look a few decades ago, it was actually disproportionately teenagers and, a child of, Greg Mankiw told me, when I was on the minimum wage, and uses that as his example. I looked it up. When he was on the minimum wage, 30% of people were like him. Now it's more like 10% of people like him. So it's actually changed a lot and become more low income, more, less teenager, somewhat older group. And I think that combined with the evidence on employment, combined with even if you don't believe a lot of that evidence on employment, it's still a distributional positive and a positive for low income families makes me think it's a good part of a solution.
Although I think you do have to also consider what the distributional benefit is versus the distributional cost, because being unemployed for the long term is about the worst thing that can happen to you in a Western democracy, short of death or dismemberment. it is when you look at the effects on people's happiness, it's the only thing people don't recover from. They recover from being paralyzed, they recover from being widowed, from being divorced. The one thing they never get happier about is being unemployed. 5 years later, they're still just as unhappy as they were when they lost their job. And so if you say, I believe the numbers were 24 million and got a raise and 900,000 would, I could be wrong about this because I'm working from memory, but if you look at that 500, it was either 500 or 900,000 people.
500,000,
right? So you look at those 500,000 people who now don't have jobs, are they, is the fact that they don't have a job at all and are completely unemployed, out of the labor market, not gaining skills, not gaining any potential entry to any other sort of job, are they, is making 500,000 people worse off to give 24 million people a small raise? And I don't, we don't know what the, you know, the total magnitude of each. You know, you're looking at the worst off people are a lot worse off. And you see this a lot with welfare stuff, right? It's like welfare reform seems to have made most of the people on welfare less poor, but then it made a core of people much, much poorer than they have been. And those sorts of questions, I think, get really, really difficult.
Yeah. Right. I mean, first of all, you've had a lot of good economists take a look at that and think that greatly overstates the employment effects, and we could, you know, go into
right.
studies and all
just,
that.
But,
and
but
even if you don't think
number,
that, even if you don't think that,
their
it's not this group of people permanently gets a raise of like 2,000-4,000 a year, which is not nothing, and these people are permanently unemployed. You still have people cycling around, and so I don't think you want to think, yeah. you know, some people can spend times in both
just,
of those states.
And a paper, oh, sorry. We just had a paper come through the seminar series here that I believe is coming out in the JP, which would challenge some of the things that you're saying, that it still is, that a very significant fraction is still not poor people who are would be directly affected by it, or that would benefit directly from it. That there, many of my colleagues have a different view of the employment employment impacts, and so we have a number of people who are our colleagues who would suggest that the employment impacts are larger. I think what was said was exactly right. You have to worry about the longer term impacts of these people not coming into the labor force or not being able to get a job. And as I said, I think it's particularly problematic now with such low labor force participation by younger people, that's going to slow things down, and we really want to get these people in. So I think the data are I think not quite as clear as what Jason was saying. This other paper suggests that these incidence issues are really quite significant today, and as well as the who is being affected by it. But I think for me, I don't think we have the data on this yet, but just seeing the low labor force participation by young people and the costs of not coming into the labor force being so high, it just seems like an ineffective way to do it. There are other ways like the EITC that you talked about, which strike me as a much more effective way to try to get to the same goal in a much more effective way.
And I was just going to interject to note that one reason I'm very happy that we're having this debate is, as academic as it can be and longstanding as the disagreements about this are, is that this is actually happening, right? Not at a federal level, but I think it's something like 36 states have already or are considering raising their minimum wages along with a lot of cities and localities. It's going to affect a huge number of workers, whereas a lot of what we're talking is more blue sky thinking, what can we do? You know, because I don't think corporate tax reform is passing anytime soon.
Right. And I do thank you, because a big part of our approach was we want Congress to act, but also encouraging states, cities, you've seen businesses like The Gap, and then we've acted as well in terms of federal contractors and requiring them to pay $10.10 an hour. And if you look in total, 8 million people have gotten a raise because of those actions, or are in train to get a raise because of those actions taken since the president first called for it. So you'd get, by our numbers, 28 million if Congress acted, but based on what we've seen so far, you're at 8 million. So
if I can.
It shows you a lot of that action, trying to encourage action at the state and local level and the importance level.
I would also, though, like to plug blue sky things, because I think you need to have something to focus on that's a little bit aspirational. And I think that I would like to see a renewed focus on labor market connection, on maintaining them. Like, I proposed, it never, surprisingly, when a journalist, a columnist at Bloomberg View proposed something, never went anywhere in Congress. But like, you could, you know, you could rebate the payroll tax 1 month for every month that someone's been unemployed, right? And give people a marginal incentive to hire people, make those workers slightly cheaper, and give people some incentive to put people who've been out of work for a long time back to work. You could have temporary government jobs that aren't real, you know, like aren't real government jobs that aren't, something like the WPA. It's, I mean, the barriers to that are enormous, right? They're absolutely crazy enormous when you think about the public sector unions and all the civil service rules and so forth. But you could think about something like that. And you could also, I really like to think see us think about deregulation, because I was talking, not just sort of blanket deregulation, but I was talking to a very nice progressive economist who left progressive economist world to start a business and then went back to progressive economist world, because he said he actually couldn't, he was in this like this Heisenbergian state of uncertainty about everything. Like, he had to hire someone to do his payroll because it was not possible for him to do it correctly. He also didn't know if they were doing it correctly, but at least like he'd transferred some of the liability, but they would charge him for stuff and he'd be like, I guess that's right. He had no way to, this is a guy with a PhD who's a very smart guy. And that this is generally, when you talk to business owners, like, it's not by any means the only thing. It makes me crazy when conservatives are like, just cut taxes for business and like cut regulation and then everything's fine. That's obviously not the case, but it is the case that when you talk to small business owners, the amount of uncertainty surrounding what they are and aren't allowed to do, and it's federal, it's state, it's local, and often those things can conflict and so forth, is enormous, and that it makes them frightened to do things and to expand. And it isn't even that these are bad regulations. It's just that like complexity doesn't add geometrically. It doesn't add arithmetically. It multiplies geometrically, right? Like every time you add a new node, the number of potential interactions just keeps growing exponentially, and it's at the point where no one feels like they can know what the relevant law is. And that's different from other countries. It's really funny when you talk to like Swedish people about business regulation, they're like, no, the safety regulators are nice. They can, you know, I want it to be safe too, and it's very collaborative, and it's not this kind of endless rule-based, incessantly multiplying craziness of regulation, and we could aspire to something like that. It's not like the Swedes have the magic good regulation gene and we don't. at least I certainly hope not. But we could think about something like a regulatory budget where every time you enact a new regulation, another one has to go away, right? Just because you're trying to minimize the complexity and you have to have priorities. But we don't make priorities about regulation, and every group has their own priorities. And the fact that every time you add seven new things, you're making it more complicated to own a business, to start a business, to innovate, just never gets counted in the cost. And you know, so instead of trying to focus on cost-benefit analysis of specific regulations, I would like to see us say, okay, like, look, this might be a good thing to do, but we can't have any more regulations and this thing is more important, rather than this is a good thing to do, let's do that, and not think about all of the other ways in which business is already burdened.
Yeah, and go ahead, Austan.
No, it looked like somebody was waiting to answer a question.
Well, okay. One last thing, because I like this thought. So really quickly, Randy and Austan, if you had your king for a day moment and you were going to implement your blue sky, your single blue sky policy that was going to help the middle class, what would it be? I think we got your laundry list.
Look, the fight about short-term things pales completely. If you take a step back, what's totally obvious at this individual level, the city level, the state level, and the national level, is those places that had more training and have a higher skill base did better in the recession, are richer, have lower unemployment, have better outcomes on every possible measure. So I don't see how that, everything that we can put into the upping the skill base of the American workforce is not the number one thing. And even if you think about regulation or you think about taxes, you have to have a mental explanation for why places like Silicon Valley are in California, which has never, ever been anything other than a high regulation, high tax state. And the answer of why it's there is because the human capital is there. That's where the people are, and that's why they went there. And it isn't on the island of Vanuatu, where I understand there's no taxation of any kind. You had no corporate taxes, no individual tax. Sometimes I'll say that to business people, like, where is this island of Vanuatu? You know, so,
but
it does remind me, there was one study which found regulation was really bad for economic growth. The United States had a lot of it. And you looked at their measure of regulation, and the best country in the world on their measure, Somalia.
Yeah, exactly. That's kind of my thing, is that, you know, you can make an exception. We live in the city of Chicago. Basically, we have very good rule of law. Your property rights are protected. You don't have to worry that, hey, we opened a factory, and then our workers woke up the next day and stole the blueprint and opened a factory across the street. And all of that stuff is supremely important for business climate. And so I think I would be dumping every amount of money, as well as just telling people, go get more skills. Just look at how people are doing who got the skills. They're doing a lot better. And so it makes me super worried. I think we have a tendency, all people have a tendency in a crisis, that the first thing you cut is the investments. So you say, oh, we can't afford that. That's some long-term thing. We're in a crisis right now. And we're in this perpetual crisis mode. We did things like, okay, well, as part of the sequester, let's cut financial aid, let's cut research and development spending, and let's cut a bunch of stuff to science and the National Institutes of Health. I think that's crazy. I think that's exactly the wrong thing if you wanna reset the middle class.
So I very much share the view that you wanna focus on G, you wanna focus on growth, because that's really the key for dealing with all of these issues. If we are not having economic growth, inequality becomes a second order issue. If just everyone is very poor, or the vast majority of people are poor, not making progress. And so education and building skills are incredibly important. So I certainly agree with that. Being a University of Chicago professor, we might say that that's sort of talking our book, because why not have the government spend more money on University of Chicago? So you have to be a little bit careful when professors say that, you know, spend more on education. So we take that with a grain of
salt. Also use more journalism.
Journalism, yeah. Yes, yes.
lots more journalism.
I'm fully in support of that.
But certainly the studies do suggest there are very high returns to education, at least now, and so there's a lot of value for you guys being here, as well as for people in who are in middle school and high school. Having improvements there can be an enormous benefits, because not everyone is able to go to a four-year college. But trying to improve basic kindergarten to 12 education is incredibly important. And obviously, we're quite far behind in that compared with many of our brethren around the world. So I would put that as at least as high a priority as sort of university and college level skill improvement. And I would put more emphasis on the tax system and the incentives associated with that. I think we have just a crazy system that is driving U.S. companies to move abroad for no good reason, except we have a system that's not consistent with the rest of the world in giving people incentives to move abroad, and so even reduce the amount of taxes that are being paid in the U.S. By these corporations who are now doing their operations abroad. In the old days, the U.S. could get away with the tax system that it had because U.S. corporations were primarily generating revenue in the U.S. The U.S. is not as large as a fraction of the world as it once was, and so it's U.S. corporations' operations abroad are a much larger fraction of their total revenues and total profits, and we have to acknowledge that. We have to understand that. Also, as I mentioned, entrepreneurship seems to be not very strong right now because we're having very low small business formation. We have to think about ways in which we can reduce, whether it's taxes or the incentives of taxes, whether it's reduce some of the regulations that make it difficult for entrepreneurs to flourish, and focus on that. And so I think education, especially at the K-12 area, and thinking about the incentives of the tax system, both for large corporations and small corporations, would probably be my two priorities.
So thanks so much, and we're gonna, if anybody from the audience has questions, we're gonna have time for a couple of them. And there's a microphone, I apologize, I should have explained. There's a microphone right there.
You know, if you want, maybe we could gather a few questions and then answer them as a group.
Yeah, maybe that makes sense. Maybe we'll take like two or three and then.
Yeah,
and then
because if everyone chimes in, we'll
the panelists will be ready to
respond.
Wow.
They're leaving. They're not lining up for questions. They're leaving.
No. I think the line is getting long.
Yeah. Okay, go right ahead, okay. Since we're...
Just wanted to thank you all for coming here. And I was wondering, I've tried to keep abreast about the economic recovery, and one thing I often read was that a lot of the jobs that have been formed are low-skill and low-paid jobs, and a lot of those jobs that are simply not coming back. Construction, a lot of factory jobs are going overseas, and a lot of the solution to the fact that there's just been this exodus of good-paying jobs has been to increase like manufacturing or increase new industries. Like Germany has been often hailed as an example of this sort of economic powerhouse that's still doing well in this bad recession. And I was wondering, is job training like, has the data supported it being like a very effective way to retool these workers? Are factory workers going to be able to move to new industries and healthcare? Is this does the data just support that job training can be a good tool to like help improve the middle class?
Okay, so let's take some more questions. Thank you so much. Go ahead.
So we talked a lot about productivity sort of in the aggregate, but I wanted to go back to that first graph where we saw productivity rising but median family income not rising with it. And I think this is sort of often raised in the context of like worker bargaining power, and are we somehow entering a world where workers are becoming more productive but not sharing the gains of it? But what seems to me a simpler story for that graph is just a mean versus a median. So like the productivity mean might be rising a lot if we have some sort of superstar effect where a few people are becoming really productive, and the median might be not rising a lot. So I guess this leads to like two possible stories. One where we have median worker productivity rising, and for some reason they're not sharing the gains of that as much, or one where productivity at the median is actually stagnant. And so I guess the second story strikes me as more convincing, but I'm curious to hear what you guys have to think about that and sort of why we see this gap. And...
Okay.
John, why don't I, those two are so
let's
related.
Let's see the third, because those two were related.
Great. Yeah.
Hi, thanks for the great conversation. That was really interesting. I heard a lot of praise about education, and I agree completely. I'm in school now, so it's a good thing for me, too. And you guys talked a lot about how education is makes you very optimistic about the future. But I have a question about another trend that I've been hearing a lot recently. That's about student debt. You know, I heard recently that student debt passed like $1 trillion or something like that. Yeah, so... how does that affect your...
This amount, you know, Washington is not helping, I don't think. The rest of the world is not helping. We go through a bubble. We didn't have a V-shaped recovery, in my opinion, not primarily because we had a lot of leverage, but primarily because you can only have a V-shaped recovery if the economy can go back to doing what it was doing before the recession began, and here it fundamentally cannot. So we need more exports, we need more investment, we need more innovation, and all of those things have gotten more complicated and more difficult as the rest of the world is not doing that well. Now that said, I think the reasons to be optimistic, and it's hard to be pessimistic once you start thinking about those reasons, the U.S. remains the most entrepreneurial of all the major economies, with the most skilled workforce of all the major economies. Our CEA people, being who they were, as we would say that to the president. The CEA people came back and said, you kept telling the president, they put that line in the State of the Union. I said, that's great. They said, no, it's not great, because technically Luxembourg has higher productivity than we have. And they were offended that we sent in the suggested edit to the speechwriters. Their edit was, except for 250,000 workers in Luxembourg, we remain the highest productivity. And they received no answer from the speechwriters. They were offended. So I think entrepreneurship, skilled workforce, as well as the remarkable, in the data, the remarkable ability, not just of startups, not just in Silicon Valley, of big companies to reinvent themselves and find new things to do, those are reasons to be highly optimistic. The university system, optimistic. But all of these are not a 12-month kind of thing, I think.
One of the, oh, please.
Well, I was going to say, you know, part of it is, part of the question is, this one's not on.
Yeah, okay. So part of the question is, can a University of Chicago graduate remember to turn her mic on before she starts talking?
No.
look, what's the baseline as part of it, right? Are we going to go back to the golden age? You know, my grandparents grew up, they didn't have running water, they did not have electricity, they didn't have central heat, they didn't have, and my grandparents lived for the first, until 1940, my grandparents lived in a room they rented from my grandfather's parents, in which they literally, like, because I believe the Chinese symbol for trouble is two women in one kitchen.
They were an international house?
No, they literally cut a hole in the wall, put their stovepipe through, and that's where they lived for the first 7 years of their marriage.
They lived in the stovepipe?
No, in the room with the stovepipe cut in the wall. And to go to that, from that to their three-bedroom house with a bathroom and a half, I mean, that was a major, right, constant improvement in lifestyle. You almost can't do that again, right? What's the transformation we're going to do from having to go out back in the Syracuse winter to use the bathroom at 3 a.m.? There's never going to be a comparable transition in future life unless it's like we just live forever as computer brains or something, right? So that experience of just expecting that every 10 or 20 years you're going to be twice as rich as your parents were is not necessarily a realistic expectation. Certainly in terms of lived experience. So, but is the baseline, I think in a lot of ways, money is the wrong measure. Like, money is a problem, don't get me wrong, money buys many useful things. But the things that worry me more are things like insecurity. This inability to think that I'm gonna have a job where I have an expectation that I can have that job for 20 or 30 years, that it will pay me well, that they won't fire me, or they won't schedule me for 20-hour shifts, that I will be able to schedule some sort of reasonable childcare for my children and not be told that, like, last week's arrangement doesn't work anymore because now you're on nights. Those sorts of things, the relative loss of status that accompanied the loss of manufacturing, and I look at the larger trends that drove that, things like trade, immigration, automation, none of which I want to shut down, none of which anyone wants to shut down, but which for the next 10 to 20 years look like they may well, as they did early in the Industrial Revolution, dominate the improvements in technology, right? In the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, a lot of people are getting poorer in terms of how, you know, you take the craftsmen of 1770, their grandchildren are living less well than they were in 1820. That's, I think, a problem to negotiate. On the long term, I'm completely optimistic because America is hugely entrepreneurial, although getting less so. We have a very skilled workforce, although in a lot of ways those skills are stalling. I think the question is, can we manage something that looks and feels to people in the middle class like their lives are improving? Even if it isn't like, you know, my parents couldn't afford to have more than a cold water flat in Brooklyn and I live in a nice house in the suburbs, whatever it is, now they're back in the cold water flats in Brooklyn. those things, even if it isn't that big a transition, can we manage a state where people feel like their lives are improving steadily? And I actually think that we can. But I think that it's going to require a lot of cultural and economic shifts that we haven't yet. I guess I'm a little more pessimistic probably than the rest of the panel.
So I share the long-run optimism of the other speakers, but I'm probably not as optimistic in the short run as Austan was. If you look at small business formation, it's been astonishingly low in this recovery. And that's something that worries me a little bit about the entrepreneurial spirit in the U.S. Labor force participation has dropped quite significantly, as Jason had said. And in particular, it's dropped a lot for younger workers. Now, part of that is because younger people are staying in school longer, and so there's more education. So in the long run, that can have some positive impacts. But in the short run, we've seen a significant drop, 7-8% for males, and not quite as much, but significant for females. People are staying at home, not forming new households. It's another thing that has been unusual about this recession, the very low rate of household formation. And this worries me. Now, some people say, well, it's the millennial generation, and so people want to share, and they don't want to own. And so obviously you guys can decide that because you're part of that generation. Maybe, but maybe they don't feel that the opportunities are there.
This is also something that's quite concerning because, you know, we sometimes talk about older workers or prime age workers that it's much more difficult to retool and to change their skill set. But younger workers should be able to do that quite easily, and people just coming into the labor force should be able to do that. But we've seen very low low entry at that stage. That concerns me quite a bit. As I said, very small, very low small business formation concerns me quite a bit. And so, I think in the long run we do have the broader entrepreneurial spirit, the broader flexibility in the U.S. economy. And my guess is we will be doing better than many of our brothers and sisters around the world, particularly Europe. But in the short term, immediate run, I think we're facing some really major challenges.
I think that's right. I think we will do better than other countries. It's just that, not that like China, right, is going to be growing faster than us, but like than other developed countries in our class, we have long done better than them. And I think we will continue to, but that's not necessarily the bar that we hoped we would be clearing.
And I think a big part of that better than them, if you look at productivity growth, you know, average over 15 or 20 years, it's been declining since the end of World War II in all of Europe and in Japan. They had this big boost at the end of the war as they recovered, and it's just been getting worse and worse ever since. For us, it looked a lot like that. And then 1995 and the 90s and internet, computer, a lot of which is right here in the United States, happened. And our productivity growth actually started rising while everyone else's continued to decline. You add to that our cyclical recovery has been a lot stronger than most of the other developed countries. And you know, I go to meetings that Austan used to go to at the OECD and elsewhere. And you know, whatever amount of negativity about the short run Randy would share with us here, you get there and everyone's just like, how can we be like the United States? We want to be more like you. We're counting on, you know, your growth to help drive our economy. I do think, you know, the question of baselines is an important one, but there's a lot of numbers between the minus 0.2 growth that we've seen since 95 and the 2.8% that we saw when, you know, your grandparents were getting flush toilets, which I think is still a little bit less exciting than an iPhone 6. But, you know, to each their own tastes. But, you know, there's a lot of numbers between those two. So, yes, maybe we can't get back, you know, the aspiration to having a 1950s economy is a little bit, you know, behind in a lot of different ways. But, you know, we're not going to have better security if you don't have better income growth.
Well, I just want to say that my column tomorrow is going to be titled, you know, 10 ways that a flush toilet is better than an iPhone 6.
You know, I would say this.
And you know that from your experience in business.
You would never. I don't even want us to go there. Just leave it. I would never get us into a debate about price indices at an event like this, but we need to have a discussion about price indices because when the economists want to have an argument about are we better off, is a median family better off than they were before? Part of the thing is, well, is the median family different? They have fewer kids. And then the other is, well, how much does stuff cost? So you make $50,000, but how much does it cost to buy the same thing? And there's a famous book on economic growth, which begins with King, I don't make up the names because I don't remember, but King Leopold the 50th, who's the richest man in the world in like 1300, and he's counting his money, and he drops the lid of one of his chests on his finger, and it cuts his finger, and he gets an infection, and he dies from a thing which for 50 cents today you could take antibiotics and you'd be cured. And so the question is King Leopold III, who's the richest man in the world in 1300, poorer than the poorest person in the United States
Calvin
today?
Calvin Coolidge's son died of, he went up to play tennis, I guess wearing loafers, got a blister, and he died.
He sounds like he deserved it.
But I mean, this was in 1924.
That question of if you have an iPhone 6 or antibiotics or
you know, I won't say our music is better, you know, than it was in the big band era. But look, there are all of these new forms of entertainment that did not exist, and somehow you got to take that into account. And one of our now deceased but great Nobel laureates, Robert Fogel, wrote this book in which he said, "Let's look at what people have spent their time doing during the day from sometime when it was like from 1400." Up to 2000, and then let's extrapolate forward. And the number one thing that we do now, that we don't do now, that we used to do, is we used to work all day long. People worked 16 hours a day, 7 days a week. There were no vacations, there were no breaks. And so a lot of what has happened has been an increase in leisure time, leisure activities, and entertainment. And that stuff continues, and it is worth something. It's just how do we embody that into real incomes?
And
I don't know how we do
it's
it.
It's one of my favorite ways to describe precisely the phenomenon that you're talking about is the Louis C.K. joke, where he's like, everything's amazing and nobody's happy, right?
Yes.
That like describes the modern economy. And it's true. But it says something problematic if one of the primary, if not possibly, perhaps arguably, the primary way in which middle class life is getting better is that stuff is getting cheaper and awesomer.
Yeah, but like,
that's bad.
I mean, you look across
what's
countries.
Why is that bad? Yeah.
It's a lot of stuff isn't getting cheaper, right?
Now we're back to the fight about price indices.
$6,000 for a household in the middle of the income distribution. So I think growth matters. The second experiment is let's now keep the growth rate constant so we have the same disappointing growth rate that we've seen since 1973. But now let's make our thought experiment freeze the income distribution at where it was in 1973. So the same aggregate gains, more of them going to the bottom 90%, less of them going to the top 1%. Now, depending on what data series you use, you get between 18 and 31% higher incomes with just the same dismal growth rate, but no increase in inequality. That translates into nearly $10,000 for a household. If you do the two of these combined, if you had the earlier growth rates and froze inequality, you get compounding, so you don't just add those two, and you get $52,000. In other words, income in 2013 for the typical household would have been almost exactly double what it actually was. You know, what I personally take from that is that growth matters, that inequality matters, and that the combination of the two, if you can get them going in the right direction, is especially powerful. Now, one criticism you might say is that experiment on growth, if we had had those earlier growth rates and everything had been shifted up 69%, that would all gone to the top 1% or the top 1/10 of 1%. You know, can't know for sure. It's certainly possible that's the case. I think there's a very good chance a decent amount of that would have been spread out. And for those of you that pay a lot of attention to Thomas Piketty, one implication of his argument is that inequality depends on the difference between R and G. R is the rate of return to capital. It's what you get on inherited wealth, dividends, et cetera. And G is the rate of return, growth rate of the economy, which is roughly the rate of return to labor or wages. And he says when R minus G rises, that increases inequality. It tilts you towards wealth and inherited wealth. Well, if G rises in that same model, it would go the opposite way, and you would think it would tend to shift income towards labor, reducing inequality. Inequality, you often hear, well, you know, even if all the income were redistributed, it wouldn't make a massive difference. I think I just went through the arithmetic. Nearly $10,000 is, I think, a pretty large difference to a lot of people. So I think that helps frame an economic agenda, is that what's happened to incomes is both a fall off in growth, especially productivity growth, and a failure to capture the benefits of that growth. But I also want to mention that third ingredient, which is labor force participation. And this has gotten a lot of attention in the wake of the Great Recession. I think a lot of people know that the labor force participation rate has fallen by 3 percentage points since the end of 2007. And it's stabilized, as I said before, but it hasn't made any move to recovering. Some of that has to do with the recession. Some of that has to do with the aging of the population. But the more you look at it, the more it's hard not to think that a lot of that was a bigger trend going on in the economy for a longer time. For men, their participation in the labor force, prime age men, peaked in 1953 and has been falling continuously since then. For younger men, especially younger men of color, it can get below 50%. For women, it rose until the mid-90s, peaked, and then started falling. So at the same time that you've had the slowing of growth and this inequality, you've also had fewer ability for a two-earner couple, for example, to offset that, or someone working full-time, as we've also seen a rise in part-time unemployment. I think the flip side of participation is Janet Yellen, chair of the Federal Reserve, identified women's entry into the economy as the single largest force in economic growth in the second half of the 20th century. And what's so powerful about it is it's an inclusive force of growth. So if we could resume raising female labor force participation, get young men of color participating more in the economy, you don't just get higher output, you get a broader set of talent contributing to that output and being included in it. So I think growth, inequality, but also just participation in the economy itself are those three key ingredients, all of which were going right in the 50s and 60s, all of which to varying degrees have gone wrong in varying decades since then. In terms of the agenda, that means, first of all, everything that just affects the overall size of the economy, I think we should think of as a middle class issue and think of in this frame. So if corporate tax reform could increase our total factor productivity or increase the amount of capital that our workers have at their disposal, it'll help solve at least some of the problems David talked about. Infrastructure does double duty. It both increases your productivity, but it also helps bring more people into the workforce. Education probably does triple duty. It helps people become more productive. It can help bring more people into the workforce, and it can raise the returns for low and middle income people to some degree, reducing inequality. I don't think all of that will be enough. So steps that affect before tax incomes, like raising the minimum wage, steps that affect after-tax incomes, like expanding the earned income tax credit for childless workers, which hopefully Paul Ryan, in his preseason appearance here, mentioned last week. It's an idea that he adopted from the president's proposal earlier this year, and we're very happy to see him do that. And then, finally, things that really focus on getting people into the workforce. So, if you look again at that female labor force participation that I've mentioned a couple times, we were ahead of most European countries around 1990. Now we're behind everyone but Japan. And at the rate Japan's going, it'll actually catch up and exceed the United States in female labor force participation. So things like childcare, paid leave, workplace flexibility can all help bring more families into the economy. No, I'm actually probably a little bit more optimistic than some of this tone conveyed. I think the United States has a lot of enormous strengths. We have strengths in education, the best universities in the world. You know, a lot of people talk about China, but there aren't a whole lot of people moving to China in order to invent things there. There's an awful lot of people moving from China and around the world here to the United States to contribute to our economy. We have, we're about to be the number one oil producer in the world. We're already the number one natural gas producer in the world. That's having important ramifications throughout our economy. Our health spending is the highest as a share of GDP in the world, which is not something I would treat as a bragging point. But the growth rate of it has slowed dramatically. It was double digits a decade ago. It's about 3% right now. I think that's also having a set of important economic effects. And then a lot of the things we're doing now, for example, historic increases in Pell Grant, opportunity to attend college, are things I would expect to see show up in a lot of the economic data we're looking at, you know, 5, 10, 15, 20 years from now. So a lot of this problem is one, and challenge is one that has taken decades to build up. The United States has a lot of strengths to confront this challenge with, and a lot of what we need to do now is both finish that economic recovery, but deal with these deeper underlying structural issues that the economy faces. And I think if we do that, we'll come back here and David will show us better charts the next time. Thank you.
For that. I appreciate, and I hope that you guys, I think everybody here just wants to hear you talk amongst yourselves, so please interrupt each other and interrupt me. But I want to start off by asking you a question, Jason, because you pointed to the data that seems to show that the recovery is maybe strengthening and growth is picking up, but we're not seeing that in wage growth. And in the big census report on family incomes in 2013, they were stagnant, despite the fact that there was some decent growth in 2012, 2013. So do you expect that some of this should start turning around if the economy gets stronger?
Yeah, so first of all, I underscore what you just said. That census report was about 2013, and we've had nearly a year of data since then. And we have seen real wages pick up in the last 12 months. They're up at 9/10 of a percentage point, which is a lot faster than the roughly zero that had preceded that. So my expectation is that, combined with the increased pace of job growth in 2014, means that when we get the census numbers for 2014, unfortunately nearly a year from now, we'll see a healthier income growth. Even in those 2013 numbers, if you looked at families, so two or more related people together, you saw decent income growth. And you actually saw it almost all in women, not in men, so that earnings gap between them narrowed a little bit in 2013. You also saw in 2013 some improvements in poverty. The child poverty rate fell 1.9 percentage points, which was the largest single year decline in poverty in 47 years. So I think in some ways you were seeing that economy starting to work for people in those data, and I think we've seen more since then.
But it seems that even with growth coming back, I think that you pointed out that it seems that there are a lot of things that are still working against families, or at least not doing much to help families out. So I want to open it up to the panel as to how much, given that right now politics is a little bit frozen, whether there's anything on the horizon that we should be optimistic about, anything that you guys are looking at or seeing that might be turning around.
Let me start by saying that I see for many of you, this is your first IOP event you've ever been to. So you cannot properly fathom what has just happened at the start of this event with David Axelrod's presentation. He's brought a lot. The IOP has been a great success. But if I had told you at any time in the previous however many years that David Axelrod would be standing before us presenting median family income data, the change in the Gini coefficient, totally understanding and following his material, you would not have believed it. You can see the influence that the University of Chicago has had on David Axelrod. And if in the next presentation he quotes Thucydides or the Peloponnesian War, his conversion to the dark side will be complete.
But still, he doesn't get an A because it wasn't in logarithms. There's still more to do.
So,
What is there to be defining? What are you, binary? We don't have an engineering department, but well, now we do. We have a molecular engineering. But what is there to be optimistic about? In the next 12 months, not a tremendous.
Good evening. Welcome to, I guess it's actually our second event. We had Congressman Paul Ryan here last week during orientation week. But this is our first event of the regular season, and one that's, I think, very apt, and it will help frame some of the other discussions we have this year. And I really wanted to have this discussion because I think that the status of the middle class in this country, the status of what we used to call the American dream, is something that's coursed through our politics for several decades, and it's created a permanent sense of disquiet that has a lot to do with the volatility in our politics. I have three slides here that kind of tell the whole story and hopefully will frame the discussion that we're about to have. This one traces the growth of GDP and real median family income from about 1960, and you see about in the mid-70s, those two lines diverge, and the economy continued to grow, but family income did not. And if you took that line back to the end of World War II, it would continue to be, it would be a straight line up until that point. So for about 20 years after the war, let's take a look at the next slide. This one runs from 92 forward. The blue line is productivity, and you can see how much productivity has grown. Obviously, technology has a lot to do with that. The GDP also has grown, but household incomes have flattened, and obviously the recession did real damage to it. And then the final slide is one that measures economic mobility across developed countries, and there you see the U.S. is down at the bottom, which is a kind of a shocking thing when you consider what we consider to be our heritage as a country, and the ability, the notion that if you work hard in America, you can get ahead, and everybody can get a fair shot. I think taken together, these slides say a lot about what is driving our politics today. And so it's perfectly fitting that the first discussion we have at the Institute of Politics is about this subject. And we have a tremendous panel and great guests today to lead that discussion. And to introduce them, let me, Will Fernandez, who is the president of our Student Executive Board. Will.
Thank you, David, and good evening and welcome to all of you. My name is Will Fernandez. I'm the senior chair of the Student Executive Board here at the Institute of Politics. It can't be a really more fitting opportunity tonight to be talking about issues that are uniquely important to each and every one of us in a unique and important way. As a college student in an era of historically high rate of student debt and a recalling workforce that leaves 16.8% of college graduates underemployed, the issues surrounding today's economic uncertainty are critically important to me and to my generation. So, with this being the case, it begs the question, is the American dream dead? Tonight, we have an unbelievable panel with some of the most senior economic experts in the country to talk about this problem precisely. Joining us tonight is Chairman Furman, who is the current chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors at the White House. Previously, Chairman Furman served as the deputy director of the National Economic Council and was an economic advisor for the Hamilton Project at the Brookings Institute and at the World Bank. Joining us as well is former chairman Austan Goolsbee, who is the Robert P. Gwynn Professor of Economics at the University of Chicago Booth School of Business, and previously served in Washington as the chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors and a member of the President's Cabinet from 2010 to 2011. His research on technology industries and government policy have earned him recognition as a Fulbright Scholar and an Alfred P. Sloan Fellow. Megan McArdle is an economic journalist, a columnist for Bloomberg View, a graduate of the Booth School, and most importantly, a fall fellow here at the Institute of Politics. Ms. McArdle has written for The Economist, The Atlantic, and Newsweek, and her seminar series entitled Inside the Policymaking Sausage Factory, What's Promised on the Campaign Trail and What Actually Makes Policy, will be held at the IOP House on Tuesdays at noon this next quarter. We also have Dr. Randall Krosner, who is the Norman R. Bobbins Professor of Economics at Booth School of Business, and served as the governor of the Federal Reserve System from 2006 until 2009, chairing the Committee on Supervision and Regulation of Banking Institutions and the Committee on Consumer and Community Affairs. And tonight, our moderator is Annie Lowry. Ms. Lowry currently is a journalist for the New York Magazine reporting on politics and economic policy. Ms. Lowry has also contributed to the New York Times, Slate, The New Yorker, and Foreign Policy. As you can see, we have an incredible panel tonight. So with that, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to thank you all for coming again and ask that you please join in welcoming tonight's panel.
Thank you very much for that introduction. Thanks, David, so much for inviting me. It's really exciting to be here in Chicago. A little challenging to get here sometimes, but it's certainly worth the trip. And thanks for starting with those slides. I actually didn't bring any of my own. You saved me from embarrassment because I would have had exactly the same slides with one exception, and in that exception, I saved you from embarrassment. I would have done them all in logarithms, which is, anyway, we can discuss that. We're in a position now where the economic recovery is increasingly strengthening. We're not all the way out of the worst recession since the Great Depression, but we're getting there. The unemployment rate has fallen from a high of 10% down to 6.1%. Even if you include broader measures of unemployment that include discouraged workers or people that are marginally attached, people that would like to find a job but aren't looking anymore, you're about 80% of the way back to where you were prior to the recession. The pace of job growth has picked up, 215,000 jobs a month instead of the 194,000 a month last year. The participation rate has stabilized since the end of last year, and you've seen wage growth picking up. It had been growing at about a 2% rate. Now it's growing at about a 2.5% rate, which is somewhat above inflation, although still not enough to keep up with the productivity that David was showing you, let alone for making up with what we've seen in the past. As this recovery unfolds, though, it puts into deeper relief the set of really deep structural challenges that we had prior to the recession. And even if we had never gone into a downturn in 2007, we would have spent the last 7 years worried about, and we still would be worried about. They're problems and challenges that were decades in the making and that will take a while to deal with. To describe them and a little bit how I think about them and how we approach them, want to divide the post-war economic period into three groups of time. The first I'll call the Golden Age. It's from 1948 to 1973. And all three things that we care about for family incomes went right over that 25-year period. We saw very rapid productivity growth. It was a 2.8% annual rate. We saw inequality roughly stable. In fact, the share of income going to the bottom 90% of Americans rose a tiny bit over that time. And then another thing that's an engine
for middle-class incomes is labor force participation. And we saw women go from about one-third of prime-age women, that's age 25 to 54, working to one-half. The combination of those three things drove the incomes for, the average incomes for the bottom 90% of households, and that's the best proxy for middle class we have that covers this whole period, drove them up at a 2.8% annual rate. A 2.8% annual rate means that the typical family's income would double every 25 years, which means once a generation, your income would double. Starting around 1973, two out of those three things that had been driving middle class incomes went off the tracks. Productivity growth slowed dramatically. It got cut in half from 2.8 to 1.4%. Inequality started rising. Over the period from 1973 to 1995, the share of income going to the bottom 90% fell from 68% to 59%. And the one thing that kept going was female labor force participation, rose from 50 to 75% over that period. That wasn't enough to make up for the slowdown in productivity and the rise in inequality. And if you look at that measure, the average income for the bottom 90%, it grew at minus 0.4% over that period. And if you do the math, that means it takes negative 175 years for your income to double. A big change from what we had seen before. Since 1995, one thing has gone partially right, and another thing has gone back in the other direction. The partially right is productivity growth has picked up, starting with the new economy, the internet, mobile broadband, and continuing through a range of other phenomena in terms of energy, health, and throughout our economy. Productivity growth has been growing at a 2.3% rate over this period. That's not quite as fast as those golden years post-World War II, but it's a lot faster than 1973 to 1995. Inequality, of course, continued to rise, and it rose at about the same rate that it was rising in those bad decades in the 70s and 80s. And then the one thing that went the other way was labor force participation helped at least salvage zero growth from 73 to 95. That stalled and started to reverse. And you've seen even prime age female labor force participation falling slightly as male labor force participation has continued its decline. Take all of that, and this measure of income growth has been a minus 0.2% annual rate since 1995. So we've gone from doubling over a generation to roughly flat over the course of a generation. To go back into those factors and give a sense of what matters for this and how much it matters, want to do two thought experiments. The first thought experiment is assume that productivity stayed on the same path it was on from 1948 to 1973. And assume also that all those gains were distributed equally. So we had the same rise in inequality we had, but all the extra income was shared in proportion to the way income is divided today. If we had done that, incomes today would be 69% higher than they actually had been if we had stayed on that post-war growth path. That translates into 36